Section 1 of Horace Walpole's Letters, a Selection. Horace Walpole's Letters, a Selection. Old Stories. Recollections of Eton. To George Montagu, Esquire, King's College, May the 6th, 1736. I agree with you entirely in the pleasure you take in talking over old stories, but can't say but I meet every day with new circumstances, which will be still more pleasure to me to recollect. I think at our age 'tis excessive joy to think, while we are running over past happinesses, that it is still in our power to enjoy as great. Narrations of the greatest actions of other people are tedious in comparison of the serious trifles that every man can call to mind of himself while he was learning those histories. Youthful passages of life are the chippings of Pitt's diamond, set into little heart rings with mottoes, the stone itself more worth, the filings more gentle and agreeable. Alexander, at the head of the world, never tasted the true pleasure that boys of his own age have enjoyed at the head of a school. Little intrigues, little schemes and policies engage their thoughts, and at the same time that they are laying the foundation for their middle age of life, the mimic republic they live in furnishes materials of conversation for their latter age, and old men cannot be said to be children a second time with greater truth from any one cause than their living over again their childhood in imagination. To reflect on the season when first they felt the titillation of love, the budding passions, and the first dear object of their wishes, how unexperienced they gave credit to all the tales of romantic loves. Dear George, were not the playing fields at Eton food for all manner of flights? No old maid's gown, though it had been tormented into all the fashions from King James to King George, ever underwent so many transformations as those poor plains have in my idea. At first I was contented with tending a visionary flock and sighing some pastoral name to the echo of the cascade under the bridge. How happy should I have been to have had a kingdom only for the pleasure of being driven from it and living disguised in an humble vale. As I got further into Virgil and Clelia, I found myself transported from Arcadia to the gardens of Italy, and saw Windsor Castle in no other view than the Capitoli immobile Saxum. I wish a committee of the House of Commons may ever seem to be the Senate, or a bill appear half so agreeable as a billet doux. You see how deep you have carried me into old stories. I write of them with pleasure, but shall talk of them with more to you. I can't say I'm sorry I was never quite a schoolboy. An expedition against bargemen or a match at cricket may be very pretty things to recollect, but thank my stars, I can remember things that are very near as pretty. Opinion of Versailles in the Cloisters of Chartreux to Richard West, Esquire, from Paris, 1739. I should think myself to blame not to try to divert you when you tell me I can. From the air of your letter you seem to want amusement, that is, you want spirits. I would recommend to you certain little employments that I know of and that belong to you, but that I imagine bodily exercise is more suitable to your complaint. If you would promise me to read them in the Temple Garden, I would send you a little packet of plays and pamphlets that we have made up and intend to dispatch to Dick's the first opportunity. Stand by. Clear the way. Make room for the pompous appearance of Versailles le Grand. But no, it fell so short of my idea of it, mine, that I have resigned to Gray the office of writing its panegyric. He likes it. They say I am to like it better next Sunday, when the sun is to shine, the king is to be fine, the waterworks are to play, and the new knights of the Holy Ghost are to be installed. Ever since Wednesday, the day we were there, we have done nothing but dispute about it. They say we did not see it to advantage, that we ran through the apartments, saw the garden en passant, and slubbered over Trianon. I say we saw nothing. However, we had time to see that the great front is a lumber of littleness, composed of black bricks stuck full of bad old busts and fringed with gold rails. The rooms are all small, except the great gallery, which is noble, but totally wainscoted with looking-glass. The garden is littered with statues and fountains, each of which has its tutelary deity. In particular, the elementary god of fire solaces himself in one. In another, Enceladus, in lieu of a mountain, is overwhelmed with many waters. There are avenues of water-pots who disport themselves much in squirting up cascadelands. In short, it is a garden for a great child. Such was Louis XIV, who was here seen in his proper colours, where he commanded in person, unassisted by his armies and generals, left to the pursuit of his own puerile ideas of glory. We saw last week a place of another kind, and which has more the air of what it would be than anything I have yet met with. It was the convent of the Chartreux. All the conveniences, or rather, if there was such a word, all the adaptments are assembled here that melancholy, meditation, selfish devotion and despair would require. But yet 'tis pleasing. Soften the terms and mellow the uncouth horror that reigns here but a little, and 'tis a charming solitude. It stands on a large space of ground, is old and irregular. The chapel is gloomy. Behind it, through some dark passages, you pass into a large obscure hall, which looks like a combination chamber of some hellish council. The large cloister surrounds their burying ground. The cloisters are very narrow and very long, and let into the cells, which are built like little huts, detached from each other. We were carried into one where lived a middle-aged man, not long initiated into the order. He was extremely civil, and called himself Dom Victor. We have promised to visit him often. Their habit is all white, but besides this, he was infinitely clean in his person, and his apartment and garden, which he keeps and cultivates without any assistance, was neat to a degree. He has four little rooms furnished in the prettiest manner and hung with good prints. One of them is a library, and another a gallery. He has several canary birds disposed in a pretty manner in breeding cages. In his garden was a bed of good tulips in bloom, flowers and fruit trees, and all neatly kept. They are permitted at certain hours to talk to strangers, but never to one another or to go out of their convent. But what we chiefly went to see was the small cloister with the history of St. Bruno, their founder, painted by Le Sœur. It consists of 22 pictures. The figures are a good deal less than life, but sure they are amazing. I don't know what Raphael may be in Rome, but these pictures excel all I have seen in Paris and England. Herculaneum to Richard West, Esquire, Naples, June the 14th, 1740, New Style. One hates writing descriptions that are to be found in every book of travels, but we have seen something today that I am sure you never read of, and perhaps never heard of. Have you ever heard of a subterraneous town, a whole Roman town with all its edifices remaining underground? Don't fancy that the inhabitants buried it there to save themselves from the Goths. They were buried with it themselves, which is a caution we are not told that they ever took. You remember in Titus's time there were several cities destroyed by an eruption of Vesuvius, attended with an earthquake. Well, this was one of them, not very considerable, and then called Herculaneum. Above it has since been built Portici, about 3 miles from Naples, where the king has a villa. This underground city is perhaps one of the noblest curiosities that ever has been discovered. It was found out by chance about a year and a half ago. They began digging. They found statues. They dug further. They found more. Since that, they have made a very considerable progress and find continually. You may walk the compass of a mile, but by the misfortune of the modern town being overhead, they are obliged to proceed with great caution, lest they destroy both one and t'other. By this occasion, the path is very narrow, just wide enough and high enough for one man to walk upright. They have hollowed as they found it easiest to work, and have carried their streets not exactly where were the ancient ones, but sometimes before houses, sometimes through them. You would imagine that all the fabrics were crushed together. On the contrary, except some columns, they have found all the edifices standing upright in their proper situation. There is one inside of a temple, quite perfect, with the middle arch, 2 columns, and 2 pilasters. It is built of brick, plastered over and painted with architecture. Almost all the insides of the houses are in the same manner. And what is very particular, the general ground of all the painting is red. Besides this temple, they make out very plainly an amphitheatre. The stairs of white marble and the seats are very perfect. The inside was painted in the same colour with the private houses, and a great part cased with white marble. They have found, among other things, some fine statues, some human bones, some rice medals, and a few paintings, extremely fine. These latter are preferred to all the ancient paintings that have ever been discovered. We have not seen them yet, as they are kept in the king's apartment, whither all these curiosities are transplanted, and 'tis difficult to see them, but we shall. I forgot to tell you that in several places the beams of the houses remain, but burnt to charcoal, so little damaged that they retain visibly the grain of the wood, but upon touching crumble to ashes. What is remarkable, there are no other marks or appearance of fire but what are visible on these beams. There might certainly be collected great light from this reservoir of antiquities if a man of learning had the inspection of it, if he directed the working and would make a journal of the discoveries. But I believe there is no judicious choice made of directors. There is nothing of the kind known in the world, I mean a Roman city entire of that age, and that has not been corrupted with modern repairs. Besides scrutinizing this very carefully, I should be inclined to search for the remains of the other towns that were partners with this in the general ruin. 'Tis certainly an advantage to the learned world that this has been laid up so long. Most of the discoveries in Rome were made in a barbarous age, where they only ransacked the ruins in quest of treasure, and had no regard to the form and being of the building, or to any circumstances that might give light into its use and history. At Ranelagh Gardens, to Sir Horace Mann, Downing Street, May the 26th, 1742. Today calls itself May the 26th, as you perceive by the date, but I am writing to you by the fireside instead of going to Vauxhall. If we have one warm day in 7, we bless our stars and think it luxury. And yet we have as much waterworks and fresco diversions as if we lay 10 degrees nearer warmth. 2 nights ago, Ranelagh Gardens were opened at Chelsea. The prince, princess, duke, much nobility and much mob besides, were there. There is a vast amphitheatre, finely gilt-painted and illuminated, into which everybody that loves eating, drinking, staring or crowding is admitted for 12 pence. The building and disposition of the garden cost £16,000. Twice a week there are to be ridottos of guinea tickets, for which you are to have a supper and music. I was there last night, but did not find the joy of it. Vauxhall is a little better, for the garden is pleasanter, and one goes by water. Our operas are almost over. There were but 43 people last night in the pit and boxes. There is a little simple farce at Drury Lane called Miss Lucy in Town, in which Mrs. Clive mimics the Muscovita admirably and Beard and Moravely tolerably. But all the run is now after Garrick, a wine merchant who has turned player at Goodman's Fields. He plays all parts and is a very good mimic. His acting I have seen, and may say to you, who will not tell it again here, I see nothing wonderful in it, but it is heresy to say so. The Duke of Argyle says he is superior to Betterton. Apology for brevity to Sir Horace Mann, Arlington Street, December 9, 1742. I am sensible that I write you short letters, but I write you all I know. I don't know how it is, but the wonderful seems worn out. In this our day we have no rabbit women, no elopements, no epic poems finer than Milton's, no contests about Harlequins and Polly Peachums. Jansen has won no more estates, and the Duchess of Queensberry has grown as tame as her neighbours. Whist has spread a universal opium over the whole nation. It makes courtiers and patriots sit down to the same pack of cards. The only thing extraordinary, and which yet did not seem to surprise anybody, was the Barberina's being attacked by four men masked the other night as she came out of the opera house, who would have forced her away, but she screamed and the guard came. Nobody knows who set them on, and I believe nobody inquired. Handel and the Oratorio. To Sir Horace Mann, Arlington Street, February 24, 1743. Handel has set up an oratorio against the operas and succeeds. He has hired all the goddesses from farces and the singers of roast beef from between the acts at both theatres, with a man with one note in his voice and a girl without ever in one, and so they sing and make brave hallelujahs. And the good company encore the recitative, if it happens to have any cadence like what they call a tune. I was much diverted the other night at the opera. Two gentlewomen sat before my sister, and not knowing her, discoursed at their ease. Says one, "Lord, how fine Mr. W. is." "Yes," replied the other, with a tone of saying sentences, "some men love to be particularly so your petit maître, but they are not always the brightest of their sex. Do thank me for this period. I'm sure you will enjoy it as much as we did." End of section one. Section two of Horace Walpole's Letters, a selection. Battle of Dettingen to Sir Horace Mann, Houghton, July 4, 1743. I hear no particular news here, and don't pretend to send you the common news, for as I must have it first from London, you will have it from thence sooner in the papers than in my letters. There have been great rejoicings for the victory, which I am convinced is very considerable, by the pains the Jacobites take to persuade it is not. My Lord Carteret's Hanoverian articles have much offended. His express has been burlesqued 1,000 ways. By all the letters that arrive, the loss of the French turns out more considerable than by the first accounts. They have dressed up the battle into a victory for themselves. I hope they will always have such. By their not having declared war with us, one should think they intended a peace. It is allowed that our fine horse did us no honour, The victory was gained by the foot. Two of their princes of the blood, the Prince de Dombes and the Count de his brother, were wounded, and several of their first nobility. Our prisoners turn out but 72 officers besides the private men, and by the printed catalogue I don't think many of great family. Marshal Noailles' mortal wound is quite vanished, and the Duke d'Arenberg's shrunk to a very slight one. The king's glory remains in its first bloom. Death of his father, the king's ill humour, Thomson as playwright. To Sir Thomas Mann, Arlington Street, March the 29th, 1745. I begged your brother to tell you what it was impossible for me to tell you. You share nearly in our common loss. Don't expect me to enter at all upon the subject. After the melancholy 2 months that I have passed, and in my situation, you will not wonder I shun a conversation which could not be bounded by a letter that would grow into a panegyric or a piece of moral, improper for me to write upon, and too distressful for us both. A death is only to be felt, never to be talked over by those it touches. Ellipsis. We are every day nearer confusion. The king is in as bad a humour as a monarch can be. He wants to go abroad, and is detained by the Mediterranean affair, the inquiry into which was moved by a Major Selwyn, a dirty pensioner, half-turned patriot, by the court being overstocked with votes. This inquiry takes up the whole time of the House of Commons, but I don't see what conclusion it can have. My confinement has kept me from being there, except the first day, and all I know of what has yet come out is, as it was stated by a Scotch member the other day, that there had been one Matthews with a bad head, another Lestock with a worse heart, and four, the captains of the inactive ships, with no heart at all. Among the numerous visits of form that I have received, one was from my Lord Sands. As we two could only converse upon general topics, we fell upon this of the Mediterranean, and I made him allow that, to be sure, there is not so bad a court of justice in the world as the House of Commons, and how hard it is upon any man to have his cause tried there. Ellipsis. The town flocks to a new play of Thomson's called Tancred and Sigismunda. It is very dull, I have read it. I cannot bear modern poetry. These refiners of the purity of the stage and of the incorrectness of English verse are most woefully insipid. I had rather have written the most absurd lines in Lee than Leonidas or the Seasons, as I had rather be put into the roundhouse for a wrong-headed quarrel than sup quietly at 8 o'clock with my grandmother. There is another of these tame geniuses, a Mr. Akenside, who writes odes. In one he has lately published, he says, "Light the tapers, urge the fire. Had not you rather make gods jostle in the dark than light the candles for fear they should break their heads?" One Russell, a mimic, has a puppet show to ridicule operas. I hear very dull, not to mention it's been 20 years too late. It consists of 3 acts with foolish Italian songs burlesqued in Italian. Battle of Fontenoy to Sir Horace Mann, Arlington Street, May the 11th, 1745. I stayed till today to be able to give you some account of the Battle of Tournai. The outlines you will have heard already. We don't allow it to be a victory on the French side. But that is just as a woman is not called Mrs. till she is married, though she may have had half a dozen natural children. In short, we remained upon the field of battle 3 hours. I fear too many of us remain there still. Without palliating, it is certainly a heavy stroke. We never lost near so many officers. I pity the Duke, in square brackets of Cumberland, for it is almost the first battle of consequence that we ever lost. By the letters arrived today, we find that Tournay still holds out. There are certainly killed Sir James Campbell, General Ponsonby, Colonel Carpenter, Colonel Douglas, Young Ross, Colonel Montague, G. Barclay, and Kellett. Mr. Vanbrugh is since dead. Most of the young men of quality in the Guards are wounded. I have had the vast fortune to have nobody hurt for whom I was in the least interested. Mr. Conway, in particular, has highly distinguished himself. He and Lord Petersham, who is slightly wounded, are most commended, though none behaved ill but the Dutch horse. There has been but very little consternation here. The King minded it so little that, being set out for Hanover and blown back into Harwich Road since the news came, he could not be persuaded to return, but sailed yesterday with the fair wind. Ellipsis. The whole hors de combat is above 7,300. The French own the loss of 3,000. I don't believe many more, for it was the most rash and desperate perseverance on our side. The Duke behaved very bravely and humanely, but this will not have advanced the peace. However coolly the Duke may have behaved, and coldly his father, at least his brother, in square brackets the Prince of Wales, has outdone both. He not only went to the play the night the news came, but in 2 days made a ballad. It is an imitation of the Regent's style, and has miscarried in nothing but the language, the thoughts, and the poetry. The young pretender sets the heather on fire. To Sir Horace Mann, Arlington Street, September 6, 1745. It would have been inexcusable in me in our present circumstances, and after all that I have promised you, not to have written to you for this last month if I had been in London. But I have been at Mount Edgecombe, and so constantly upon the road that I neither received your letters, had time to write, or knew what to write. I came back last night and found 3 packets from you, which I have no time to answer, but just time to read. The confusion I have found and the danger we are in prevent my talking of anything else. The young pretender at the head of 3,000 men has got a march on General Cope, who was not 1,800 strong, and when the last accounts came away was 50 miles nearer Edinburgh than Cope, and by this time is there. The clans will not rise for the government. The Dukes of Argyll and Atholl are come post to town, not having been able to raise a man. The young Duke of Gordon sent for his uncle and told him he must arm their clan. They are in arms. They must march against the rebels. They will wait upon the Prince of Wales. The Duke flew in a passion. His uncle pulled out a pistol and told him it was in vain to dispute. Lord Loudon, Lord Fortrose, and Lord Panmore have been very zealous and have raised some men, but I look upon Scotland as gone. I think of what King William said to Duke Hamilton when he was extolling Scotland. My lord, I only wished it was 100,000 miles off, and that you was king of it. There are 2 manifestos published, signed Charles, Prince Regent for his father, King of Scotland, England, France, and Ireland. By one, he promises to preserve everybody in their just rights, and orders all persons who have public monies in their hands to bring it to him. And by the other, dissolves the union between England and Scotland. But all this is not the worst. Notice came yesterday that there are 10,000 men, 30 transports, and 10 men of war at Dunkirk. Against this force we have, I don't know what, scarce fears. 3,000 Dutch, we hope, are by this time landed in Scotland. 3 more are coming hither. We have sent for 10 regiments from Flanders, which may be here in a week, and we have 15 men of war in the Downs. The Jacobite Rebellion, to Sir Horace Mann, Arlington Street, September the 20th, 1745. One really don't know what to write to you. The accounts from Scotland vary perpetually, and at best are never very certain. I was just going to tell you that the rebels are in England, but my uncle, in square brackets old Horace, is this moment come in and says that an express came last night with an account of their being at Edinburgh to the number of 5,000. This sounds great, to have walked through a kingdom and take possession of the capital, but this capital is an open town, and the castle impregnable and in our possession. There never was so extraordinary a sort of rebellion. One can't tell what assurances of support they may have from the Jacobites in England or from the French, but nothing of either sort has yet appeared. And if there does not, never was so desperate an enterprise. One can hardly believe that the English are more disaffected than the Scotch, and among the latter no persons of property have joined them. Both nations seem to profess a neutrality. Their money is all gone, and they subsist merely by levying contributions. But sure, banditti can never conquer a kingdom. On the other hand, what cannot any number of men do who meet no opposition? They have hitherto taken no place but open towns, nor have they any artillery for a siege but 1-pounders. 3 battalions of Dutch are landed at Gravesend and are ordered to Lancashire. We expect every moment to hear that the rest are got to Scotland. None of our own are come yet. Lord Granville and his faction persist in persuading the King that it is an affair of no consequence. And for the Duke of Newcastle, he is glad when the rebels make any progress in order to confute Lord Granville's assertions. The best of our situation is our strength at sea. The channel is well guarded, and 12 men of war more are arrived from Raleigh. Vernon, that simple, noisy creature, has hit upon a scheme that is of great service. He has laid Folkestone cutters all round the coast, which are continually relieved and bring constant notice of everything that stirs. I just now hear that the Duke of Bedford declares that he will be amused no longer, but will ask the King's leave to raise a regiment. The Duke of Montague has a troop of horse ready, and the Duke of Devonshire is raising men in Derbyshire. The Yorkshiremen, headed by the Archbishop, in square brackets Herring, and Lord Moulton, meet the gentlemen of the county the day after tomorrow to defend that part of England. Unless we have more ill fortune than is conceivable, or the general supineness continues, it is impossible, but we must get over this. You desire me to send you good news. I confine myself to tell you nothing but what you may depend upon, and leave you in a fright rather than deceive you. I confess my own apprehensions are not near so strong as they were, and if we get over this, I shall believe that we never can be hurt, for we never can be more exposed to danger. Whatever disaffection there is to the present family,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.